Good afternoon, everybody. It's Sunday, it's 12:02, and it's PPG World Services. And this is Nikki Touch, and I'm here with my co-host, Louise Stapleton-Frappell, who is in Spain, and Rebecca King, who is in Texas. Ladies, good afternoon.
And good afternoon, Nikki. How are you?
I am very, very well. So before we sort of start and get going, I just want to say that today's show is proudly sponsored by PetChute Pod. Two of our fabulous PPG Summit vendors that will be at our in the exhibition hall at this year's summit. And we'll talk a little bit more about them in just a few minutes because they both have some marvelous products. But we're actually having some technical difficulties. We're having problems getting Helen onto the show. She's based in England. So Louise and I will just do some bantering and hopefully we can resolve that. And if not, then we'll just have to go with the flow and chat, chuckle and share about something else.
Yeah, it's always a shame actually when people have problems. And I tell you what, I really sympathize, Nikki, because how many problems have I had in the past when I haven't been able to get on the show?
I know. And, you know, I remember years ago when I first lived in the States, I lived in an area that just had satellite and internet. And it was really frustrating because the minute there was a cloud in the sky, it was impossible to get on webinars or do anything through the internet. So I appreciate how difficult it can be sometimes for folks to jump on. It's not always that easy. And if there is any problem with weather or severeness of anything in any location, it can make it even more difficult. But I think one thing we're pretty good at is just chat, chuckling and sharing. So why don't we have a chat about Helen and her summit presentation? And both of us sat through a similar presentation in England a couple of years ago. So we can sort of chat about that and hopefully in the meantime, Helen will find her way with us.
Yeah, absolutely. Helen actually presented at the Pet Professional Guild British Isles mini summit that we did. And absolutely fantastic presentation. Actually, she gave a couple of presentations, didn't she?
She did. And you've heard me say this on shows before when we've sort of got into the discussions about walking dogs, just how much I really appreciated her going for a Bumble presentation. But actually, Helen's teachings all come from the great knowledge and skills and passion that she has for clicker training dogs. And Helen has a training center called Clicker Gundog. She's written some books about this, and she's really passionate about the gundog sport and being able to do it with clickers. And you know, the success that she has shows that we just don't need to be using aversive tools, even in the dog world sports or the sort of, you know, the sporting environment.
Yeah, absolutely. She was really, well, she still is heavily involved with the CAP programs, the competency assessment program from Learning About Dogs. She's still an active assessor, actually, I think, for the scheme. So she's got a CAP 1, CAP 2, CAP 3. Obviously, she got more with distinction. And it's really funny, actually, Nikki, because going back, gosh, I'm trying to think now, it's quite a few years ago, Helen actually it was the person who was my mentor when I did my CAP 1, 2 and 3. So it's funny how you run back into people.
Right, and it's probably one of the reasons why you're such a good mechanical dog trainer, because of that, of working with Helen and going through that course.
Absolutely, yeah. And you know, it is, and I think it is, it's really important. But the other thing that especially Learning About Dogs taught me, which I use so much now and pass on to the students that I teach, is that it's also got to be fun. Everything's sort of made into a game, so we're using positive reinforcement, we're being as thoughtful as we can be about our training and as precise as we can be, so that we've got clarity of communication with the dogs and with our human students. But it's also all about having fun. I'm going to turn this back round actually again, because you've already mentioned the title of Helen's presentation, and you quickly said it was going for a Bumble. There's going to be loads of people, Nikki, that have got no idea what a Bumble is. Can you explain it?
I can, and I was actually going to go there. And the context of how I was that was that, and I read this somewhere else recently, and I'm not sure, someone did a really fantastic blog about this, or it came out in Psychology Today or something, I don't recall. Anyway, I digress. Going for a Bumble speaks to, and obviously going for a Bumble covers quite a large area of skills and context and knowledge, and it really is very interesting to listen to. And Helen's a lovely presenter. She's got a wicked sense of humour, and obviously is very passionate about her topic, and comes from a very different context, because not very many of us I don't think so. I mean, I certainly haven't in my career. I've spent a lot of time with positive gun dog trainers. It's just not a world that I'm really exposed to. So I think when you get to listen to experts within our industry that have come from different contexts, you pick up some golden nuggets of information. And I think for me, the really important thing for me was, in terms of going for a Bumble, is that, you know, if you context, I live on 24 acres, I live quite rurally, and I take my dogs for walks around this property 2 or 3 times a day. We do it just A in the morning and then B in the afternoon. Steve and I go pick up chickens' eggs when I go to our school room, so we're always going out and about, and I'm always on a mission to go from A to B, and it's like, come on, let's go, and I'm reinforcing my dogs for doing that, but they have to sort of walk where I want to go and at my pace. And whether I'm walking the sort of perimeters of 24 acres, or whether I'm going from A to B to C to D, same time I'm looking at my watch thinking, okay, that's an adequate amount of time. Yeah, they've had good exercise. Let me do a couple of downstays and comes so that I can get them sprinting, because, you know, they need to sort of, you know, let off some steam. And I listened to Helen's presentation and I thought, oh my God, when I think about how I exercise my dogs, it is totally on my program and to my goals. And it's nothing about them, other than I feel as a dog owner that you have to get out and walk your dogs. And Helen talks so much about just going for a Bumble and how dogs don't walk around perimeter fences and they don't go from A to B in a straight line. And being out there and walking a mile and then back, which is what a lot of pet owners do, that sort of mandatory walk my dog for a mile, walk my dog back, put my dog in its crate, get my clothes on, go to work. It's just not how they would do it. I came back and immediately and it's funny because my husband was like, I told you so. He's been saying this the last 22 years. Just let them do whatever they want. Let them go wherever they want. And if they don't want to walk through that gate into that pasture because they'd rather spend 10 minutes sniffing in that spot, let them do that. So that's what going for a Bumble about. It's about going out with your dogs and just enjoying the Bumble. Just let them go where they want to go. Don't sort of rush them on a mandatory course of, you know, from A to B and then back from B to A. Let them enjoy it, let them smell, let them sniff, and be on their program, because it's for them primarily. You know, unless you're a professional walker, or you know, I used to run marathons many years ago, and my first dog, Dobie, was trained to run up to 16 miles a day with me. And when we went out for runs, obviously we had to run in a specific way, at a specific pace, on a specific track. But generally, many pet dog owners are just taking their dogs out to enjoy going for a Bumble. So let it be a real Bumble where they can sort of suck up everything they want from the atmosphere in terms of, you know, the visual, the scent, and everything that they are really enjoying for mental enrichment and also physical. And I think as we all know, and, you know, feel free to jump in here, Lou, many of us are now starting to realize that in many cases, that the mental enrichment is as good, if not better, than the physical. And if they get everything they need, they don't need to be, you know, running at a high pace for 40 minutes. I mean, how many times do we hear dog trainers dispensing information to owners? You must exercise your dog twice a day for 30 minutes. Well, how can we dispense that when that 30 minutes is so different for everybody in terms of what they're doing or how they're doing it or what the dog needs or wants or desires? So that's what I learned from going for a Bumble. And there's obviously a lot more to it. Helen's probably cringe if she listened to me because I'm oversimplifying it.
She's listening. She's listening in.
No. So that was the one thing. And Helen, I always thank you for that. And I can't tell you, a week does not go by when I'm not talking to somebody about their dogs and that doesn't come up in conversation. About how it just, you know, and I consider myself a dog expert, how it completely changed the concept of how I go out with my dogs and enjoy time with them now. And if my dog's frisky and play bouncing, then we get out a frisbee or a tennis ball, or we run, or we do some high pace recalls. But other than that, it's just on there. It's to their program, how they want, what they want. And everybody just enjoys it so much more. It's fabulous.
Absolutely. And with that, guess what? I'm going to say, Helen Phillips, hello, welcome to PPG World Service. And let's see if Helen can get off mute. I'm hoping so, because I can see she's on here.
There you go.
Woohoo!
Welcome!
Wow, that was tricky, that was.
Hi, Helen. Sorry, we explained to everybody that you were having a few technical difficulties. So glad you've managed to get on.
Yeah, I think we're sorted now. I think I'm up and running.
Good.
Perfect. So what did you think of Nikki's description of going for a Bumble?
Oh, it's very good. Very impressed.
You're very kind, Helen. Oh my goodness. Did you hear me talking before that about how passionate you are about the gundog world and positive reinforcement and...
No, I missed all that, unfortunately. I came in just at that last bit when you were talking about taking your dogs for a Bumble and how much it had changed your life.
Yeah, just, you know, because I used to feel it was kind of a mandatory. We have to do two perimeters and walk a mile and we have to go now and come on, let's go, let's get some pace. And now it's just like I have a coffee cup in one hand and a cookie in the other and off we go.
Yeah, that's brilliant. That's what it should be about.
Yeah, just enjoying. So, yeah. Helen, I know you're really passionate about Clicker Gundogs. And how did you get involved? I mean, were you a gundog handler that became obsessed with training, or were you a dog trainer that suddenly became obsessed with gundogs? How did that all evolve?
It began really, I've always had dogs myself. I grew up with dogs. And I was really interested in shooting. When I got married, it was kind of a hobby that we both did together. And the passion grew from there.
Right.
So basically it came from me training my own dogs to work in the field. And then as time progressed on, I actually had some extra time. So I thought I'd like to look into training a bit more. And when I did that, I actually found that I quite enjoyed it.
Right.
And from there, I went on to teach him, really.
You know, I don't know if you've ever done this or you thought about this, and I'm just having some ideas here, Louise. It would be really cool to actually build a 6 or 8 week group class curriculum around some of the skills required for gun dogs that trainers could run in normal group class environments just to tap in some of those natural instincts for all the working dogs that we come across.
Oh, I see. Yeah. So like building a program that was written for them that they could follow.
Yeah. I mean, how cool would that be? Yeah,
it would be very, very, very cool. And maybe it's a project that might happen not next year, but possibly the year after.
Okay, excellent. Because, yeah. I mean, how many of us in group classes get the pointers and the setters and the retrievers? And how wonderful it would be to be able to sort of, you know, give pet owners the skills to be able to sort of tap into some of those natural instincts as a way of sort of giving them enrichment and exercise.
Yeah, I agree totally. I think it I think it's often sort of avoided as well because people are a little bit scared of it because they think if they encourage their dogs to do those things that they will actually lose their sort of little bit of connection or relationship that they have. But I find that it works the opposite way, that the more that you sort of communicate with your dog in a way or level that they understand and encourage and develop their own skills, then your relationship and connection increases.
Excellent. I thought you were going to say that if you teach them how to do that, then you can never teach them not to do that. I thought you were going. I thought not you saying that, but the perception, because it reminds me of in the confirmation world when. Yeah. People say, oh, I can't teach my dog to sit because then I can't get it to stand in the ring.
I agree. Yeah, that is so true. And the dogs are just naturally versatile, that they are so good at being able to adapt to what the context is.
Yeah.
And I think that's the point that people miss so much, is that a dog can recognize like when they're on holiday and how the context changes then when they go to the pub. That's a different context. You behave in a different way. And so that there is no reason why they can't understand when they should be hunting or working or expressing natural behavior and when they should just be, like we discussed a few minutes ago, just going for an ordinary social walk. They can do both. So they can live in a pet home and they can still be a dog and specifically a gun dog if we're talking about those breeds.
Right, and that reminds me of another crucial part of your presentation that I really enjoyed when you were talking about the context of the land they were walking on, and when they were walking down sort of pathways in pasture, they were walking very nicely by the side of the owner and they'd walk through gates, but then when they got onto that land that was more bush, then they recognized that different behaviors were coming into play, and the owners were then being able to cue them to do other things.
Oh yes, yeah, they're so good at doing that. And if you just teach the owners and the handlers to just adapt themselves, you know, right, and change the cues slightly, so learn how to change their own body language, then the dogs trigger very naturally on 1 minute hunting and the next minute, you know, being social.
Right.
So yeah, it's very important, I think.
Yeah. Do you think that's to do with the setting events and the context of the owner, the location, and the ground, versus suddenly when the ground changes, the owner's body language changes, and the environment changes? Or how would you explain that from an applied behavior analysis perspective?
I think it's a mixture of both. I think first of all, you need to teach them how to do it together. So both handler and dog need to learn the specific behaviours, and for that behaviour or behaviours to be put on cue. And then you start adding in the context of how the environment changes and impacts on it. So then you teach the handler how to be far more observant and to recognise when these things are going to happen. And then they can then set themselves up for success. And after a while, the dogs then begin to pick up on the context.
Yeah. I mean, we all know, don't we? It's like in the morning, well, actually, after this show, I'm going for a bike ride. And the minute I pull out a certain specific pair of shoes, my dog looks all miserable because she knows they're bike shoes and she can't.
Yeah.
But, you know, they're amazing, aren't they? They can just discriminate so well between different things. Yeah.
Yeah,
and what I found really interesting, Helen, was in your presentation description, you actually said that a lot of owners of gundogs have actually been discouraged from taking their dogs for a walk in the past.
Yes, definitely. It's one of those things that breeders will often tell them, that, oh, you've got a gundog, you can't do this and you can't do that. Well, this day and age, most gundogs actually live in pet homes. There are far more in the pet home than there are in a working home. And the downside of that is that then the families never actually really appreciate the relationship that they can have with their dog. For me, it's not just about the sort of going for a walk and going hunting. It's the other things as well. In that sort of, some of the myths are that with gun dogs, you should never play. You should never allow them to have toys. You should never let them interact in that way, because they're a gun dog and they shouldn't do those things. But if you're not actually going to work your dog to a high level of competition, and you just want a good all-round family pet that you can do lots of things with, then that should be encouraged, because that's how you actually build your relationship. And for me, oh, sorry, go on.
No, it just, I'm having these, I'm not a parent, but I mean, would it be somewhat like having a child who was 9 or 10 who was a superb athlete, but yet never allowing them to do any of those things, that you're just missing out on being able to share time with them of things that you both could mutually enjoy and get massive amounts of reinforcement from?
Exactly. Yeah, that's what it's all about. And, you know, they just love being able to play. They love having toys. They love chasing balls. They all those kind of things that, you know, every sort of pet dog should do, a gun dog will love to do. And they also, even if you're going to train, you know, more formally, and you actually really want to work your dog, then encouraging them to do all these things, you're building up high value reinforcers that you can later use when you're training. So it actually is a win-win situation.
Right, right. What dogs do you have, Helen?
At the moment, I've got Hungarian Vizslas and a Springer Spaniel.
Okay, I love the Springers. Love them. My ex-boss in Hawaii got 2 Springer Spaniel puppies. I don't think he and his wife had any idea what they were taking on.
And
every morning I would see him running 4 or 5 miles with these dogs. He was almost, his nose was almost on the ground. These dogs were, they had so much energy. They were unbelievable.
I know what you mean. Yes, they are full of energy, very, very busy all the time.
one of those dogs that people buy because they just love the look of them without really thinking about what these dogs are bred to do, and then they realize they've got a bunch of trouble on their hands if they don't somehow channel it.
Oh, I know. Yes, that was really, really interesting. You should mention that. I had someone in class this morning who came for the first time. She's got a beautiful little working Cocker Spaniel. And she was doing her introduction and saying, you know, why she got to Cocker Spaniel. And that was because she loved the way that they were so busy. And then she turned around a couple of minutes later and said that she also wanted a dog that she would be able to teach to walk very well at heel and to recall back when she wanted. And of course, everybody thought that was highly amusing because cockers are one of the most difficult to be able to teach to actually walk to heel because they love to go in circles.
Yeah, well, it's funny you say that because I'm not even sure if Louise knows this. Louise knows me quite well, but the very first dog I ever got was when I lived and worked in Cairo in Egypt. And yes, I got a Cocker Spaniel. Who I named Cookie, who was the most delightful little black Cocker Spaniel until she hit like 3 or 4 months of age. And I was a 25 or 6 year old, so I knew absolutely nothing about dogs. My goodness. Yeah. I learned a lot about dogs with that dog, Cookie.
They teach you loads.
They certainly do. She was absolutely delightful, but my goodness, I mean, I had a Kelpie years later, and my Kelpie didn't have anything on that Cocker. I mean, in terms of energy or inquisitiveness, it was amazing.
They are brilliant. They're absolutely full of energy, but they're, you know, they are very focused, very intelligent, and you have to be on the ball.
Mm-hmm. Do you recognize any differences between the American and the English cockers, other than the looks different, isn't it?
Oh yeah, their looks are different. Yeah, I mean, I must be honest, I haven't actually worked in the field with an American cocker. I've only ever done some clicker training skills with one, so I don't really know how they would work.
Right. Yeah, I've been in the States for 22 years, and to this day I'm still surprised when I see certain breeds, the difference between what I recognize as dog breeds in the UK growing up in England, especially with some of the Labradors and the Retrievers and the some of the Irish Setters, and they're just almost completely different looking dogs.
Oh, they are, yeah. Yeah, and I do think some of that is to do with how you develop what you're going to do with them hunt-wise. So their requirements might be slightly different. So different traits are encouraged and others are discouraged.
Right, right. Okay.
We could do a little experiment, Nikki. We could get Helen over to do a workshop and have a work with some of the American ones.
You know, it's funny you say that, because when I met Helen in England a couple of years ago, I asked her about the potential to come out here, and I think this would be a perfect piece of land to do some working dog training.
Sounds great.
Yeah, I'll have to regroup with you when I see you this month, in a couple of weeks. Yeah,
definitely. Yeah. You've just got to watch out for the alligators, Helen.
Yeah, that's the only thing that worries me, yeah.
It's okay. Nikki's really good. She'll take you out on a nice canoe on the lake. She'll point them out to you. There you go.
Oh, brilliant. I look forward to that then.
I believe in the winter, if it's below 70 degrees, they don't feed. So it's the safest time of year to be going by the lake. Actually, let me tell you, and I was blaming Kelly Fahey for this, because last night about 11:30 at night, I had some questions about some of our vendors at the summit. And I decided to walk down to our school room, which is halfway down our property. So in my pajamas with my dog and a torch at 11 o'clock at night, I was trudging through the fields thinking this is a very, very stupid thing to be doing, given that the alligators are quite active at this time of year. So, yeah, not only did I have wet feet, but I, wasn't very sensible.
Doesn't sound sensible at all to me.
Anyway, we blame Kelly for that. So anyway, before we go any further, we're just going to take a short break, and Louise is going to talk to us a little bit about Pet Tutor and Popod, who are two of our proud sponsors at this year's PPG Summit. So Louise, what do you know about Pet Tutor, and is that how you pronounce it? Popod?
You know what, Nikki? I have got to admit that I don't know how you pronounce it, but I think it's Popod, no?
Oh, yeah.
Popod.
Have you Helen, have you heard of Pod?
No, only from what I've read about it since the summit information.
Right, because apparently they've invented, well, they've not apparently, they have, they've got this really cool tool that's driven through a smartphone that actually you can increase the difficulty of it as the puppy gets older and becomes more experienced. And Kelly and I were actually talking about Pupod last night on the phone because we also think it's a fabulous tool to keep dogs that are on bed rest or crate rest mentally stimulated, because people are always asking, oh, my dog's injured, going to be in a crate for 6 weeks, how can I keep it, you know, how can I keep it active? And we were thinking that Pupod could do some great marketing, because we think that would really, really serve that purpose in terms of keeping dogs entertained and keeping their minds going. So I think there's a huge potential with Pupod. But Pupod and Pet Tutor are sponsoring the welcome drinks at this year's summit, so huge thank you for that. So you will get to see them there. So Lou, what else do we know about Pupod and Pet Tutor?
Well, I know, as you said, that Pupod's build in sort of really high-tech products for dogs that promote mental stimulation and physical activity. And they've been developing software-driven dog toys to promote behavior modification and to allow humans to basically interact with the dogs in new ways. And what they're focusing on is basically this new, I'm going to say, internet age, you know. Everybody's online, we're all sort of connected to technology, and that's where they're putting most of their focus. So I think it's really interesting. And you also mentioned Pet Tutor, which Pet Tutor, well, we know reasonably well, because they've obviously, I think they've been at the summit every year, haven't they, Nikki?
Yeah, they have. They're big supporters of PPG. We love them, and they've got some great products, and
again, I think people probably know a little bit more about Pet Tutor, because that is basically a smart wireless training and game system for the pet. And I know we spoke to them before, we've actually had them on PPG World Service, and they were telling us about they've used the Pet Tutor quite a lot in rescue shelters, haven't they, Nikki?
Yeah, correct.
Which is great. It means that they can basically remotely feed the dogs. So, for example, somebody comes in, let's say, to the kennels, and the dogs can be being fed, and it's conditioning that positive emotional response from a distance. So, yeah, two absolutely fantastic products. And as you said, they're actually sponsoring the Summit drink and the lay, which I've got to admit, Nikki, before all this started, I didn't really know much about leis. Now, obviously, you lived in Hawaii, so you do.
Yeah. Well, yeah.
What's the purpose of them? Is it just, I've seen that when people sort of land on a plane or arrive at a hotel or whatever, they're given a lei.
I could impress you by speaking a little bit of Hawaiian here, but if any of my Hawaiian friends hear me, I'll be ribbed for it forever. It's a Hawaiian culture. It's a very polite way of wishing somebody, you know, greeting somebody, like saying, you know, thank you. It's a very honoring way to greet someone, to say hello. It's very ingrained in the Hawaiian culture. So most of the hotels in Hawaii, when you arrive, they will offer you a fresh orchid lei and a nice drink. So we decided to do that at this year's summit because the hotel we're staying in is very sort of tropical and very, you think you're by the sea. And the leis actually will have quite a significance, because the leis will be, well, I'm not going to say too much, but the leis will be, through your lei, you may win some really cool prizes for the duration of the summit. So it's basically, it's a nice way for us to say, welcome to the summit. Here's your lei, hang on to it. Here's a nice drink. And yeah, welcome here and really enjoy it. So yeah, it's a really nice Hawaiian culture. I was actually reading something on the news yesterday about it, funnily enough. There's some stuff on Hawaii. So yeah, and it's spelled L-E-I, and they range in, well, basically the ones we used to use at the Orchid at Manalani, the hotel I managed in Hawaii, they were all handmade. So people actually have, you know, big businesses creating and making and constructing Hawaiian leis, and if they're looked after properly, they can last for several days. And some of them, the male leis are also made from tea leaves and vine leaves, so they're very regal. And the more important you are, the nicer the lei, and specific flowers are used for specific purposes. So
Oh, wow. So is it going to work like that at the summit? The more important you are, the you're going to get a different level of lay. Oh, okay.
But we've also got some very funny props. So our plan is that as people arrive, we'll take some fun photographs of props and use them for social media and have some fun with them. So, yeah, it's all going to be fun.
Okay, cool.
And actually, talking about the summit, in a few minutes, I'm going to give away a free summit ticket and a hotel accommodation for 4 nights. I am going to be asking a question. Yeah, so we'll go back and chat with Helen for a few minutes and then I'll interrupt and ask the question. But if you are interested in winning this free summit ticket and hotel accommodation, here's how it's going to work. I'm going to ask a question which you have to answer correctly. The first person that answers it correctly will win the ticket. You have to notify us by typing the answer into the chat bar below. So when you type your answer, also type there your email address. After we finish this meeting, we will download all those answers on a report and we'll be able to see from time, date, stamp who was the first person to get the correct answer, and then we'll email you, but you'll know pretty quickly. Now, the question, the answer, you may have to do a little bit of research on, but let me hint and tell you that you can use all the resources at your disposal to get the answer for this question. So when you get the question, get smart and get creative about potentially where you need to go. The exception is that myself, Louise, and Rebecca cannot give you the answer, so don't email us, but you can find the answer by using any other resource. And I will ask that question in just a few minutes, but for now, we're going to whip back to Helen, who's far more interesting to talk to.
Yeah, and you know what? I'd like to ask you a question, Helen, about games. You touched on it before.
Okay.
You said the importance of playing games. Now, before you actually came on, I was saying how you had very much influenced my training and actually been my mentor when I went through my CAP 1, 2 and 3 a few years ago. And oh. I've also been over at Kay Lawrence's establishment. I've been to quite a mm-hmm. few of her workshops. And there's a massive focus on not just training thoughtfully, but also on making the training playful. Can you tell me a little bit about that?
Well, from my point of view, I actually think that most of the things that you teach that are really games. They're not, sometimes things get too serious when you're actually training.
Yeah.
And if you focus on it more as being a game, and that everything that you teach is like playing a game, then your relationship actually works better with the dog. And I think that the behavior that you would teach or establish from that is also far stronger.
I totally agree. Everything that I teach, whether it's online or with my students here, well, number one, it sounds a bit strange, but I call everything a trick because it makes them think about things differently, and it does make them more playful. But number two, absolutely. It is all a game. It should be the training game. I just think it really impacts. I don't know about in the working dog field, obviously, but in, you know, with pet dog owners, getting them out of the mentality, you know, some people are pretty set, I'm going to say, in the old ways of commanding their dogs. As soon mm-hmm. as you start teaching them that everything's a game and that they can be playful with their dogs, you find that they start asking their dogs rather than telling their dogs?
Oh, yes. Definitely, yeah, that really changes that whole perception of what it's about. But also as well, I mean, the majority of things that we teach our dogs, they're not really what should we say, life or death things anymore. I mean, even the hunting years ago, it obviously used to be to put the food in the freezer, but now really it is just done as an activity or as a hobby. So the way it should be approached, in my opinion, is that it is purely for fun and purely as something that you do between you and your dog. And when you start looking at it like that, what you actually find is that both participants enjoy it far more, because it's like the pressure has been lifted off it, and that they can, it's okay to laugh and it's okay to engage with your dog in that way. And if even if that something goes wrong, it's not the end of the world. It could, you know, it's part of learning.
Absolutely. And what are some, have you got some examples of I'm going to say some of the games or some of the foundation skills but that you teach initially that helps make people more playful with their dogs? Have you got any examples of how you would teach something?
Well, probably there's several. There's the hunting game. We play that as a game where we teach the dogs the skill to start searching and to use their noses and to do it with the handler. So that's one game that we play. We play the this way game or catch up game. There's two parts to that, which but one helps with the recall and the other one helps with beginning to develop connection when you're outside in the field and also with heel work. So those are a couple of games that takes the pressure, especially with walking together. There is so much pressure on that behaviour that the dogs find it so difficult to do that when you actually turn it into a game where you say to them, right, the onus is on you. You have to find me and catch up with me rather than the other way around. They actually start to really enjoy it.
Okay, and is that something that you'd use when you were going for a Bumble, or is that just something that you'd use in actual training?
Both. It can feature in both of those.
Excellent. I was going to say that's good that in a way then you're teaching a skill that you can use it in both things. You can use it not only in their working life, but also, you know, in their life when you are just going out for a walk. In what ways would something like that game actually be helpful with, I'm going to say, with a pet dog?
Okay, well, most of the time we have social constraints, don't we, when we own dogs, in that you have to go to certain places where your dogs have to either be on a lead and to walk fairly close with you, or to actually be able to be under control. I'm not so sure what your rules and regulations are in the States, but certainly over here, if you're working across a lot of farmland, your dogs have to be under control if there is livestock about. And one of those difficulties is that actual behaviour of walking with you. And so when you play it and you teach it through a game where you put the onus on the dog to actually learn the behaviour that you want, then they own it and they are actually able to do it much better and for much longer.
Okay, is that where I was reading your learning objectives for your presentation, and one of them is how to develop the invisible piece of string? Would that come in here?
The invisible piece of string sort of works throughout everything. When you're out and about with your dog, it's like instead of you worrying so much about what your dog is doing or where your dog is, you actually swap that over so that they have to worry about where you are and what you are doing.
That's really interesting. One thing that Nikki and I have been talking about actually a lot just very recently is how to help people to encourage their dogs to focus a little bit more on them, to realize that there's somebody else maybe on the other end of the leash, or you know, actually just them, which very obviously a big thing is down to the relationship, but a massive part of it is the positive reinforcement, I think. But also, you know, the being playful that we've just talked about comes into it as well, because you know, if you're not very interesting and you're not very involved with your dog, then why on earth would your dog pay attention to you?
Well, exactly. And also I think sometimes as well, when you get your little puppy, you're very worried about what your puppy is going to do, or what are they going to get themselves into trouble-wise. So you do spend a lot of time watching, following and checking your puppy. But the downside of that is that basically they learn that you are always going to be where they've left you, and you were always going to be around. So then they don't have to pay you very much attention at all, because you are doing all the work. And the downside of that then is, as they get older and the environment gets more interesting, they pay less attention to you and more attention to the environment. Because even after they've disengaged from you for a while, you can guarantee you'll be exactly where they left you.
You know, it's funny you say that, because years ago there was a school of thought that when you get a puppy that you should like let the puppy get lost from you a couple of times, and when the puppy finds you, have a big celebration, and it actually teaches the puppy to keep their eye on you rather than the other way around. And my very first dog, other than Cookie, my Egypt dog, was a dog I got in Hawaii in 2000, and we lived on the edge of Parker Ranch, which I think is the biggest independent ranch in the US. And we had full permission to use the ranch road. So with my husband and I would run there, and we used to go out with this puppy, and one day the puppy wandered off and we hid, and it took her a few minutes to find us. And I swear, day four, that dog never let us out of her sight. And that wasn't something, we hadn't done that intentionally, but when I read about it, I read that there was a school of thought to do that. Now, obviously not to the point where you traumatize a puppy, please don't misunderstand what I'm saying.
Yeah, exactly, yeah.
You know, but I thought that was interesting. When you said that, you're right, we do tend to micromanage everything they do, don't we? And then we suddenly expect them to be paying attention to us.
Exactly. Yeah. And I mean, that's what it is all about. Most of the time when people take their dogs out for a walk, is they follow the dog. And so the dog just learns to continue to go where they want to go, because you will be not far behind. And then the downside of that is that you are struggling then if you need to change anything, or to get your dog to come away from something, or you know, you want to go a different way, because they really aren't connected to you.
Yeah, interesting. Well, I think it's time for the question. So I'm going to throw out the question. I think this is quite a clever question, actually. So if you're on this call and you're interested in a free summit ticket and 4 nights hotel accommodation at PPG Summit in Mickeyland, which is also Orlando, the question is the following. And remember, if you have the answer, you can throw it into the chat bar below. Now, actually, it suddenly occurred to me that if somebody may not get the correct answer, so if they don't, then we'll throw something out on Facebook. So the question is, Project Trade is the PPG International Advocacy Program for our Shock-Free Coalition. It's a program where members join it and access to all our marketing and literature and information to help them not only attract new clients, but to also trade aversive equipment for small service discounts. And each month, members of Project Trade submit a report into PPG with a photograph of all the equipment they've traded and little client signatures as part of a control process. And the person that has traded the most equipment becomes the PPG Ambassador of the Month. And that gets them $100 credits towards free webinars and a certificate of acknowledgement. Now, the question is, who was the Project Trade Ambassador in April of 2017? So your question is, who was the PPG Project Trade Ambassador in April 2017? So that's the question, and you've got another, 10 or 15 minutes to find the answer. And remember, with the exception of myself, Louise, or Rebecca, you can tap into any other resources that you know of in PPG or on the website or on the internet to try to find that answer. So the Project Trade Ambassador in April 2017, and you will win a 4-day hotel accommodation and free summit ticket for the PPG Summit in Orlando. So thank you for that quick interruption.
Wow, great prize. Can you tell us a little bit about the Summit Hotel, Nikki, as you just mentioned it?
As we just mentioned it, yeah. It's 3.5 days of presentations. I think there's 28 presenters are coming. There's 7 or 8 PhD doctors. It's at the Buena Vista Hotel in Orlando. It starts off every day with general sessions, and in the afternoon we break out into 7 tracks. We have some great fun activities, gala dinners, chat and learn with the presenters. It's just an all-round 3.5 days of really great education, fun, and networking. It's lovely.
Yeah, I think it's going to be amazing. And I'm actually really looking forward to the location this year. We've been in Tampa for a couple of years, which has been absolutely fantastic. But personally, I've never been to Orlando, and it's meant to be a fantastic hotel. Because last week, Ken McCourt was actually talking about it and saying that he vacationed there and what a fantastic hotel it was. So I think that's going to be really cool. So in any downtime that you've got, folks, then you can go out and enjoy the theme parks or the swimming pools at the hotel. So Helen, make sure that you bring your bathing suit and you can go out and have a swim.
I'm really looking forward to it.
Oh, the weather in Florida in November is absolutely delightful. It's lovely.
Oh, brilliant. Yeah. Brilliant.
And a little bit of extra information, actually, about Helen's actual presentation, Going for a Bumble. It's going to be on 2 days. So on Saturday, November the 18th, and on Sunday, November the 19th, because we do have a few tracks, as you said, Nikki, running at the same time. So that will mean that if people, you know, who are attending can't catch it one day, they can catch it the next day, which I think is brilliant.
Yeah.
Because it's definitely not to be missed. I'm going to catch it, even though we've heard the presentation once. I'm really looking forward to listening to it again.
Yeah, I'm going to go watch it as well. Absolutely. Yeah, just to put some additional pressure on Helen.
Yeah, thanks for that. Yeah.
We'll sit in the monkey gallery in here.
Yeah.
Oh, my goodness. Anyway, I think we may have had a correct answer already. So I don't know if Rebecca can confirm.
Wow, that was quick. Somebody either knew straight away or they're very good at looking things up.
Yeah, we do. We're the first person that answered. Should we announce it now, Becca?
Sure.
Yeah, okay, let's announce it now. Okay, well, Brianna Norris at 12:46. Brianna, you have won. The person was Agnes Cavalettes, I think that's how you pronounce her name. Agnes was... she's been Project Trade Ambassador a few times, actually. She does a fabulous job. So, Brianna Norris, you have won the ticket for the PPG Summit. You put your email address there, so Rebecca will shoot you an email. But, yeah, so if you've already signed up, then you'll have to find somebody else that you can give that ticket to. So, fabulous. Good job. That was great. And anybody else on here? Yeah, a couple of other people got the right answer. They just weren't quite as fast off the mark. So...
excellent. Well, many congratulations, eh?
Good job, Brianna. Wonderful. Okay, love giving stuff away. It's always nice when it's a member as well. Yeah.
Absolutely. Well, before we round up the show, I've got one last question, actually, that I'd like to ask you, Helen. And that is, okay. I know that part of your presentation is going to focus on hunting and scenting games. Would that be applicable to pet dogs as well? Could pet dogs get involved in some of these scenting games?
Definitely, definitely. I think that's one of the most important things that they should be doing. What I tend to see a lot of is that people who have sort of dogs that are predisposed to doing this kind of activity, they spend all their time discouraging it and trying to stop the dog from doing it. So, as a result of that, they often end up sort of like fields apart from each other. Then the dog has one agenda and the person has another, and that never the twain shall meet, shall we say. But if you actually start engaging in your dog in these activities and encouraging them to use this, not only do you get that relationship back, but the dog starts looking at you as much to say, well, you do know a little bit about what you're talking about, so maybe I will listen to you a little bit more when we're out and about. And the connection between the two of you develops, and the fun that you can have is great. But not only that, it's also as well, it's kind of a very relaxing activity for the dog to sort of work with their nose and work with scent. And they get a lot of stimulation out of that. And you can see that when they've done some of these games and they've played for a while, that you really don't need to go for long walks anymore, because they get enough from that engagement with you and being able to scent and search.
Absolutely, I couldn't agree with that more. And I'm talking from a pet dog viewpoint. That I know I do fun scent games classes for my students, and they, their dogs afterwards, oh my gosh, well, dogs and humans have such a fantastic time, but afterwards everybody says, oh wow, they were so tired, they slept all afternoon.
And well, I think it's because basically what it does is it releases lots of the good sort of chemicals in the brain and in the body, the feel good endorphins and hormones like that, which then, especially with the adolescent dogs, that helps neutralize some of the adrenaline and testosterone and other hormones that might be surging at that time. And so the dogs are more sort of calm and more relaxed about things. It really does help.
Definitely. And I'd also say, again, going back to the pet dog guardians, I think it really helps them as well. I think they do really connect with their dogs, and they have such fun and work, whether we call it work or play, they're working with their dogs in a totally different way. And it is, it's just great fun. So that's something else I think we need to chat a little bit more about in the future, because I do think, you know, it is
very important.
So important. You know, there used to be that old thing, I don't know, I'm sure you must have heard it, that people would go for walks and they wouldn't even let, you know, just walking from A to B and not even let the dog sniff. You know, oh no.
Yeah, that's terrible. Yeah, I mean, that's the other thing I think that, you know, what we're talking about it at the moment is that it's detrimental to your lead walking, because, the dogs, you have to ask yourself, why does a dog go for a walk and why are you going for a walk? And often the objectives are two totally different things. A dog's sort of idea of going for a walk is to take in the environment, take on board all the information it has, send what's been around, who's been there, you know, what animals have been about, all that kind of stuff. Our agenda is sort of to get from A to B, and that's it. And so the downside of it is that for the dog, going from A to B is really not stimulating and really not useful to them. And we've got to change the people's idea about what going for a walk is all about.
Yeah, which brings us right back actually to what Nikki was saying at the start of the show when you just joined us, that used to think, you know, it's about getting from here to there as quickly as possible so that they get a quick walk in a certain time period. And in fact, it doesn't actually really matter how far you go, just let them enjoy having a sniff.
You don't have to go anywhere. You just have to let them enjoy the environment and enjoy taking on board what's been going on. Let them do their sort of reading of the newspaper.
Absolutely. I've got one German Shepherd who's fantastic at reading the newspaper.
Yeah.
I've got to admit, occasionally I wish she'd flip the pages a little bit more quickly. But
she's too busy doing the crossword, Lou. Maybe she's just
that's right. I've got one dog. Well, Helen knows Jambo, so she knows sort of little bit about what Jambo's like. So I've got one dog who just wants to chase around, and the other dog's like, nope, I'm just going to spend half an hour here, thank you very much.
Yeah, that's so true.
But hey, they're all individuals, and they do, they're definitely different. But I do think that it is really important, and I think the fun scent games, I don't know, I just think that there's so much fun for the owners as well. I don't think until the owners actually participate in fun scent games that they realize how much that both they and their dogs will get out of them.
Oh yeah, I agree.
Absolutely, yeah.
Yeah.
Cool beans.
Well, that was absolutely fantastic talking to you, Helen. I'm so glad you managed to get on, because otherwise I'd have been listening to Nikki for another hour.
Oh, well, if you feel like that.
Sorry, Nikki.
I'm so glad you got on, so it could have avoided me getting insulted at the end of the show.
All right. You know I love you, really, Nikki. It's just that, you know, your explanation of going for a Bumble was really nice. It was. But, you know, what can I say? It's just good to get it from the horse's mouth, so to say.
Absolutely. And this is one of those shows that doesn't happen very often where we can honestly say to Helen, we'll see you in about 9 days.
I know. It's amazing, isn't it?
I know. I mean, in fact, if you just wait like 20 seconds, I'll tell you exactly how many days, minutes and seconds it will be. It'll be 10 days, 6 hours, 1 minute and 39 seconds until the summit starts. So I hope you got your bags packed.
Oh, my God.
Wow.
I can't wait. I'm really looking forward to it.
Yeah, I'm really excited. I'm going to really enjoy it. It's a lot of work getting there, but once I get there, I get a chance to see all my mates that I work so closely with throughout the year and just catch up with all the members and spend some time with some great people. It's just wonderful. Wonderful. All righty. So with that, are we saying goodbye, Lou?
I think we're saying goodbye. And actually, no, we're saying hasta luego. We'll see you all soon. Yay. Right. 10 days. Yeah.
Take care, everybody.
Bye.
Bye. Thank you, Helen.